Good afternoon. I am David Sternberg, General Counsel of Brown Brothers Harriman & Co., and today's moderator. Let me briefly introduce you to the other panel members whose full bios are in the conference materials. To my immediate right is John Savarese, litigation partner, Wachtell Lipton. Continuing down is Robert Mundheim, currently of counsel, Shearman & Sterling. Next to him is Judge Raymond Lohier, U.S. Court of Appeals for the Second Circuit, and also a former federal prosecutor. And at the end of the panel line is Michele Mays, General Counsel and Corporate Secretary for the New York Public Library. Before we begin, I wanted to make three brief comments on behalf of the panel. The first is that the views we each present today are our own and may not reflect the views of the organizations with which we are affiliated. The second is we encourage you to raise your questions as we proceed, and we'll find a way to stop and answer them. And third, as you can see, we're working with a hypothetical. And while the hypothetical involves a for-profit entity, we're aware that there are a number of not-for-profit attorneys in the room, and the issues are often the same. And therefore, this should be translatable to the types of clients with which you work. With that, let's begin with the hypothetical. My Drugs is a pharmaceutical company headquartered in New York with a market cap of $5 billion. Earlier today, the CIO notified the CEO of a cyber theft involving 50,000 documents. The CIO reported that risk management and compliance were creating an inventory of the stolen documents, which would take several days to up to 2 weeks to complete. He also reported that the systems division had implemented a patch that closed the pathway through which the unidentified hacker operated. Michele, what do you think the CEO should do at this stage?
Well, let's assume that person has his act together, so he's actually got a business continuity and crisis management binder on his laptop or on his device, so he can simply pull it up and everything will be answered, and then we can just go forward. And now we go to the real world. So let's assume that there haven't been any tabletop exercises and there's no ready-made list of everything he should do, and so he's going to convene a meeting of key internal people immediately. And those internal people, at a minimum, remember there's a subsidiary as well as a parent company involved in this matter. That would be his general counsel, his chief information officer, the compliance officer, the risk officer, and probably CFO, if I had to guess, at a minimum. And then there has to be a discussion as to whether individuals from the subsidiary are included. And my guess is you're going to have to do that to some degree if you're trying to get at the facts. The thing that he should probably want to discern immediately is what is known and what is not known. Because at this point in time, I can't tell, for example, in those 50,000 documents whether there's any personally identifiable information, which would also start a shorter fuse. When was the breach discovered? How confident are they that the pathway to the breach has been closed? So depending on how those facts shake out, he could then move to the next phase, which is to determine who should lead this matter. And I think it's extremely important to identify one individual so that you have a neck to choke or a cheek to kiss. But to have everybody in charge means that no one is in charge. I would vote for the general counsel so that that individual can deputize who he needs or she needs to have in the inner circle, and from there also have a discussion as to whether outside counsel needs to be engaged. I can't tell you right this minute where I would fall out on that, but at least initially those are the thoughts that I would take immediately. I would just raise one other thing. I would caution the CEO not to fire anybody immediately, even if that's an inclination, because that sometimes is where you should ask the question, do any personnel actions need to be taken? That is, does anyone need to be placed on leave? Does anyone need to be removed from a position? I doubt if that's the case, but as a CEO, I would certainly ask the question. And then I would go on to say, who else needs to be alerted?
Okay. Thank you. Michele. I think two follow-up questions come from the points you made. One, maybe, John, if you don't mind, I'll direct to you, which is Michele spoke about deputizing a group to handle this, and that the GC should be the one doing the deputations. Here, in this, at least in this stage of the hypothetical, the risk management and compliance function have been asked to do work and it doesn't appear as if the legal department was involved at all in getting them involved. Should the general counsel deputize risk management and compliance as they do this inventory of stolen information? And can the general counsel do that with respect to work that's occurred to date?
Sure. So I think the answer to the first question is easy. Yes, the general counsel should deputize whoever now is doing work, because we've got a potentially big enough problem that you can already see at least the glimmer of potential legal risk, potential legal claims, and you therefore should immediately start thinking about preserving privilege. Privilege cannot be protected in this instance if lawyers have nothing to do with the ongoing work. Indeed, quite helpfully for this panel, the Western District of Arkansas so held in a case involving Walmart just literally 2 weeks ago, where the judge there was presented with the question, work being done by compliance personnel looking into then very inchoate allegations of bribery in Mexico in the operations of Walmart, which have since blossomed into one of the great scandals of all time. In the early days, though, there were no lawyers involved, at least on the record before the court. No lawyers were supervising or directing the non-lawyer compliance personnel who were conducting the initial round of investigative work, and none of their reports were going back to any lawyer. So the court held, I think correctly, on that record at least, no privilege, no Upjohn privilege, and therefore all of that work product and all of those materials get turned over to the plaintiff's lawyers in the ongoing federal securities claims still pending against Walmart. So early on, if you have something that's looking like it's going to be a nightmare, the way David's wonderful hypothetical does, you want to get the lawyers, the in-house lawyers, deputizing non-lawyers to conduct a review at their direction, under their supervision. You want to direct those people. You can put, you know, attorney-client privilege, attorney work product legends. You should send the reports to me. And then you will have satisfied sort of the leading case in this area, which is the Kellogg, Brown, and Root case from the D.C. Circuit, decided in 2015, that quite clearly holds you don't have to be a lawyer to be asking the questions, so long as you're asking the questions at the direction of a lawyer.
John, what went on
beforehand, I don't think you can fix. I don't think you can put the genie back in the bottle. You have to just act prospectively.
John, I agree with that.
Suppose the head of compliance is a lawyer, as the head of compliance often is. Will that investigation be all right?
Yeah, it's a great question, and one to which there's no obvious, clear, settled judicial answer. I think the better argument is that when a compliance function is just functioning in the ordinary course of business, doing its normal supervisory, you know, systems checking kind of work, that does not attract privilege. I think in this instance, if it were a compliance person with a law degree who said, you know, I'm going to go talk to the general counsel, I'm going to make sure that we really are engaging lawyers to think about this, supervise this, and think about the looming legal risks, then at that point, privilege attaches.
But that gets you the deputization. Suppose what they've done some work before he goes to the general counsel and says, I was a lawyer. Mm-hmm. Therefore, it ought to be privileged.
I think, can I jump in for a minute on that? I think, Bob, most companies are pretty good these days about creating a record well before a crisis of whether or not they view an attorney, someone who has a JD working in a compliance function, as operating as a lawyer within the organization. And an easy answer would be if that record is not there, and if they are, and it is quite clear that the company does not treat that position as a legal position, then I don't see how you could make a privilege attach at this particular point in time, because it goes against corporate practice.
It depends also on how you've set up your reporting.
Yeah. Right.
Sometimes a compliance department does report to the general counsel,
right,
and it is viewed as a legal function. But increasingly, a lot of companies have moved away from that model.
Yeah, and in the financial services industry, which I know we're not in right here, I mean, the regulators are pretty clear these days that they view compliance as an independent control function, not hampered by the ethical considerations that that a lawyer would have in terms of zealous representation.
Yeah, and I wouldn't take that gamble. I would
rather
go to a lawyer who's functioning as a lawyer full time,
right,
rather than having that debate come up. And the other thing that I think is extremely important is that when you deputize, it's got to be by a memo. It cannot be because someone comes into your office and you say, okay, now you're anointed. There's got to be a paper trail of it.
Yeah. So let me...
But what you're really raising is whether or not when there's no crisis, there's nothing. You've got to characterize whether the head of compliance is to be treated as a lawyer or as
not.
A non-lawyer.
I agree.
Yeah, correct. One last question on this piece of the hypothetical, and then I will have otherwise utterly failed in my moderator's duties to keep us moving along on the time allotted, which is a question for the judge. The hypothetical assumes it may take as long as 2 weeks to figure out what documents have been taken, and it does, well, we haven't made this a big cyber-focused hypothetical. The genesis of the problem is cyber-related.
So all I saw was cyber.
And so what does cyber specifically do in terms of accelerating things here?
From I was in the government and the head of the securities fraud unit in Manhattan for a number of years, and particularly years where the issue of cyber crimes had increasing salience,
mm-hmm,
and importance. To me, represents a crime, a cyber crime, either a straight cyber crime for example, insider trading purposes.
Mm-hmm.
It could be cyber espionage by a foreign company or by a foreign state. Those are the sorts of things that on the criminal side, as a matter of law enforcement, the FBI, for example, would want to know. And would want to know as soon as possible. In part, that's because this company, My Drugs, may not be the only company that
mm-hmm
has been hacked.
You're not saying that most people run into the arms of law enforcement.
I'm saying that they should.
I know, but they don't.
But the problem here is that it is an issue that I think a criminal law enforcement person would view as not necessarily unique to the company. There are ways for an FBI head of cybercrimes, I know this happens in New York, to maintain the confidentiality of the information
mm-hmm
that's provided by the company. But without that information being provided by My Drugs, there's really nothing that the FBI can do. And if it is a bigger issue, that is a hack that's affected a number of different other pharmaceutical or other companies, that piece, that is the My Drugs piece, may be a critical piece that can help
mm-hmm
solve the larger problem. And
I agree.
I don't know that you want to be in the position
of going on your own and not having.
Right.
I agree with you. But in that vein, let me tell you what I think companies need to seriously think about, which goes back to the first part of this when I was making the remark that if you had your action plan together, one of the items on your action plan is to have a relationship with key law enforcement
yes
folks in your community. So you are not calling them for the first time, spelling your last name.
So that was going to be
right
my last point, which is if you talk to any FBI official who's in charge of their office's cyber crimes unit, they will tell you that one of the most important things that GCs can do or compliance folks can do is to keep in regular touch, to go over to the FBI and say hello. Obviously, I don't speak for the FBI, so they'll have to tell you that themselves, but say hello, and if there is a problem, then there is it facilitates the information mm-hmm. flow, and you develop this rapport with the main contact person, either at the federal level, or I'm sure that it could also take place at the state level. Or local level.
Okay. With that, then, let me take us to the next paragraph of the hypothetical. The next day, my drug's head of risk informs the CEO that the work to date established that among the stolen items are documents relating to the sales program of N Drugs, a subsidiary. The stolen documents include correspondence with doctors who raised questions about the incentives for my drug sales representatives, emails by junior employees debating whether my drug's general public disclosures about its sales practices properly accounted for N's practices, emails from terminated employees in the New Jersey office stating that they were terminated for poor sales performance because they refused to offer fancy gifts and entertainment to doctors, and finally, internal memoranda raising questions about the sales levels achieved for two of N's major drugs, which exceeded forecasts based on expected market size and penetration levels. Bob, leaving aside contact with regulators and law enforcement at this point, focusing maybe on the board and outside counsel questions, at this point, what should the GC advise?
Well, one is we've got serious questions about sales practices in the subsidiary, including special gifts to doctors, which may be a violation of law, mm-hmm. and disclosure issues for the parent. I would think, one, the board's got to be notified pretty promptly. Too many people already know about the sales practices and disclosure issues, and it's not a good idea for the board to hear about those issues from somebody else. They want to hear from you. I know one of the questions one has is, well, I don't have a lot of information. I've got a lot of, I don't know. Well, tell the board up front, I want to let you know this is the problem. We haven't started our investigation. There are a lot of things we don't know. You had talked about developing a relationship with the regulators or the enforcement people. It's also important for the general counsel to develop a relationship with somebody on the board to whom they talk and with whom they have a really deep relationship. And that's probably the board person to whom you might, if you've got questions about timing, that you'd want to talk to. I know that when I was general counsel at Solomon, Lou Simpson, the chair of the audit committee, was the person with whom I developed that kind of a relationship. We always met for an hour before the audit committee met, and we would talk frequently in between.
But Bob, even if you didn't have a special relationship, if you were going to at least initially contact someone on the board, wouldn't it at least be the chair of the audit committee, chair of risk, and maybe the chair of the board?
Or chair of the board, yes. No, I think that's absolutely right.
Okay.
All I'm saying is I think one of the things as a general counsel that you want to do if you can is build a relationship. It just makes life a lot easier. Mm-hmm. Now, the next question is who should gather the facts? Probably the best people on documents and people to interview are the subsidiary folks. But for the reasons that have already been suggested, you can't put them in charge. How about the parent general counsel or control people? Again, I think they can be very useful in getting information produced, which is very important, and getting people with whom you should be having interviews to be cooperative. But I think I would bring in outside counsel, and I would do that very quickly. this is a fast-moving scenario, and you can't wait.
So do you think they need a computer forensics expert, though?
Pardon?
I said, do you think you need someone that's an expert in cyber forensics rather than just outside counsel?
I'd want somebody who's dealt with this kind of situation, and that's one of the very great advantages of going outside. They will have had a look at a lot of these situations, will have a better sense of what questions do you ask, what can you expect, how do you deal with the media, what can you expect from them, with regulators.
But again, if you were Michelle's point, I think the steps are you get outside counsel involved and then have them bring in a forensic cyber expert so that their work is covered by work product, their communications are privileged, and you establish a relationship such that the outside counsel is bringing in an expert to assist them, you know, bring that expertise to the table so that in turn you can give the right kind of legal advice to the company.
I think that's great. I think one other point on bringing in outside counsel. Inside counsel is often viewed, particularly by regulators, as having an advocacy function and therefore can't really be fully trusted to tell you everything you ought to know as a regulator. I think the reason...
I'm not going to comment on that, but okay.
Yeah, there you go.
And one thing that outside counsel, the regulator knows, if you've picked an outside counsel who's done this before, is they're going to be back with somebody else, and therefore preserving their reputation for being thorough, honest, and cooperative is important.
I do agree that it's trust. This is my experience based on prior relationships. And so that is usually not the case with in-house counsel. In fact, I can't remember a single case where a presentation was made on the criminal side, to the criminal law enforcement folks, where that presentation was made by in-house counsel as opposed to outside counsel.
Right.
You think it matters which outside counsel you hire?
Yes.
Can you just go there? Because I'm struggling with whether you've got a law firm that's got the deep understanding that you need already involved with your company, or whether you're going to end up going to a firm, preferably that has never done work for your company, or do you think it matters?
I'm going to take the first stab on that one, I think, being like you, Michele, in the position of having to hire counsel. I think there are always a few things that you consider. First, some counsel come with baggage from all of the representations that they've done up until the one that you're contemplating using them for. That baggage may mean that they're presented as a very aggressive, for example, litigator and a very combative counsel. And that may very well not be the posture that you decide you want to take with the U.S. Attorney's Office for the Southern District or any district. That also may not be the type of counsel who is going to be able to interact well with your management. And so you may decide to disqualify them, even though that's somebody who, if you look over the last 5 years, their winning record in dealing with cases involving the False Claims Act or other things is, 90%+. I think in general, you're looking for somebody who has deep knowledge in the area that they're going to have to advocate on in your behalf, who is going to be able to efficiently work their way through your organization so that they uncover what occurred, who is able to communicate to your management so that they can then make the decisions that are within the realm of business judgment that can be made in the context of the crisis. I would say, just speaking personally, it is at the margins when you get concerned about whether or not, if you're using a firm that's known you a long time, will the particular outside entities with which you're dealing with feel like they've been co-opted and are not fulfilling the honest broker position that the government is expecting when dealing with them.
And may I add something, David?
Yes.
Again, based on personal experience, it's not a binary. It's not an either or. You could have two sets of outside counsel, particularly
in cases.
Oh,
good.
Then
we have lots of money being spent.
Yeah.
Never my problem as a regulator.
Yeah.
But if it's a particularly complex issue that where you think the counsel with whom you're familiar has more familiarity, more expertise, you might want to combine that with another set of outside counsel that has more familiarity, frankly, with the regulators.
Yeah.
It's not a question of that outside counsel not working with the general counsel.
Yeah.
They will, and that's very important. I think the other question that I saw in your comment, Michele, was if you've got outside counsel, could that be counsel who's done a lot of work for the company, or is it regular outside counsel?
That was built into the
yeah.
My comment.
I think that's a tough question, and often I think you'd say that's all right.
Yeah.
And certainly it doesn't mean that law firm has done no work for
right.
the client.
That's
I think is easier. You don't have to get somebody who doesn't know the company at all.
Right.
One of the questions with longstanding counsel would be, is there any indication they're involved? Did they give advice along the way on sales practice stuff? Does their corporate practice give you the 10B5 letter that you're relying upon in connection
yep.
with your public filings? If there's any of that going on, then you pretty much have to bring in somebody else.
In fact, I would say that the regulator, at least the U.S. Attorney's Office in the Southern District of New York, would kick out that counsel. Would
yeah.
say,
you can't
be involved.
Right. You're a witness, essentially, yeah. at that point, as opposed to an independent investigator. But let me keep us moving now. And I think just briefly, John, one of the other questions that comes up, given what we know, at least in this paragraph of the hypothetical, is whether or not the calculus on reaching out to the regulators or law enforcement has changed in your view?
Sure. Look, I think everything the judge said before is right. A lot of what you're hearing from us is that good preparation makes for good crisis management. So you need to have a board that's been well briefed in advance about how management will handle a crisis. The better job management has done, the better your board will take these problems in stride and know we're going to put in place a plan, we're going to have an investigative program, we're going to have a media program, et cetera. Likewise, in dealing with the FBI in the cyberspace, it is absolutely right, as the judge said, every time the FBI cyber experts give a speech, they begin and in the middle and then at the end they say, call us, and call us in advance and have a relationship with us, because we really want to hear about your systems. We've got a lot of expertise. We're seeing a lot of different things. So being prepared in that sense, I think, is good. And that would allow you to perhaps have a call with the FBI that doesn't necessarily trigger a full-blown investigation of absolutely everything before you're ready to do it. But to come to David's question, I think the real thing that is looming here is that at some point we're going to need to get other regulators, not necessarily people with pure cyber expertise, involved. We're going to talk to the FDA because we've got pharmaceutical issues. We're probably going to be talking to the SEC at some point because we have potential financial disclosure and financial integrity issues. And we're probably going to be talking to the U.S. Attorney's Office, too, because there's potential criminal liability arising mm-hmm. from some of the things that are being uncovered and that we're starting to see in the hypothetical. I am a firm believer that you don't do those things until you at least have a halfway decent idea of what the problem is, and most importantly, that you have developed a cogent plan of action. Because the way I like to do this, and I try not to be too aggressive, that's why I'm so shy.
Yes, exactly.
And calm at all times. The way I like to do this is I go to the government and say, remember me, I'm the guy who comes to you frequently with these kinds of things, and here is the plan. I'm hiring a forensic expert to help me with cyber. I'm hiring so-and-so to help me with the pharma pieces of it. This is how we're going to work on it. We've told the board. The general counsel is supervising this. I expect that it will take me, you know, 1 week to do A, 2 weeks to do B, and 3 weeks to do C. And at each point, I'm going to come back to you and give you an update report so that you frame for the government that you have some control of the situation. You've got a game plan that they can actually rely upon and that they don't need to instantaneously start issuing subpoenas. If you've thought carefully in advance and really have a plan that's cogent and credible, they will not, in my experience, start issuing subpoenas instantly. Mm-hmm. They will actually wait and give you a chance to get some work done.
Question?
Yes.
I'm just wondering why you think you'll have 3 weeks. Won't this break in the media and won't you have maybe a couple of days at most?
It depends. I mean, there are lots and lots and lots of things that don't break in the media, thank God, even though, you know, my long ago boss, Justice Brennan, would probably shoot me for saying that, you know, something shouldn't be in the media. But seriously, there are lots and lots of these things that unfold quietly. But you're right. I mean, if it breaks in the media, then you've got to move faster. But that doesn't mean that you can't actually give the government a game plan. Like, you know, a good example, when MF Global collapsed, Congress went crazy, the media went crazy, the government went crazy, and, you know, on literally day one, we were scrambling. But the one thing I was able to do was to say to all the various regulators, you know, give us a little bit of time to get to the bottom of it. Today, I don't know anything. Here is my plan. I'm going to come back to you in a week. I'm going to come back to you in 2 weeks. I'm going to come back to you in 3 weeks. And it worked, because there was actually a lot to learn that no one knew on day one. And, you know, convincing somebody of that is a critical part of that first contact.
But you raise a very good question, which is, as you're planning the crisis, you've got to have options that you bake into your strategy. And the strategy this hypothetical is at least giving us some flexibility to deal with is a strategy that doesn't have a Twitter hit. It doesn't have the hacker starting to engage in insider trading in your company's stock, although it's something that you have to worry about.
But David,
you would have to assume that you could lose control of the timing, though, and you would therefore have to bake into what you were doing a defensive PR statement and a set of Q&As for employees who are outwardly facing, the ability to speed up your dealing with the regulators if externalities were forcing you to speed up. So you're absolutely right that you've got to worry about that.
Social media accelerates and amplifies all of these things. United is a perfect example. That never would have been a crisis, right? Back in the old days, no one would have known that they dragged this doctor out. It wouldn't have been a problem at all. So David's right. You have to have a backup plan in case there's media. And you have to also be candid with yourself and with your board that in the era of social media, at least round one, if not round two, three, and four, you lose. You just will. There's no idea of winning on round one in that context. But you have to be smart and know you're actually in a long war. And it's going to, and then, you know, if you make mistakes on day one, they'll come back to bite you later.
But that's why I would include the corporate communications function as part of the early team, even though you can't bring them into the inner sanctum without being worried about the privilege. They have to be involved and making a decision on whether you need an outside crisis management person to augment that group.
Okay. I think we had a question over from the second row. Yes.
The facts unfold. If once it comes out, people find out they're sitting on it.
Yep.
And
yep.
Involves personally identifiable information, for example, not just hypothetical.
Yeah.
You've got to think about when you're going to sort of start the.
Absolutely. And you have to break and you have to break that out into the different constituencies that you have to deal with. You may have a need to have an internal communication right, as employees start to see resources being diverted to deal with the crisis and they start to sense that something's going on. You can have external constituencies, suppliers. I mean, you can name the list, but you're right. All of that, and I fully agree with the point Michele made, that's the type of thing a general counsel would be encouraging a member of his or her staff to be working with the corporate communications department on. Okay, let me move us along. The next paragraph, actually, I think we're going to skip. We all loved it till we got into the prep room just before we sat down with you. And this discussion was the FDA and SEC are unlikely to force you to pick who does the fact gathering for you. But if they did, privilege would be the issue that you would be fundamentally concerned about. And I think we've talked about the privilege issues in the context of answering one of the earlier questions.
But you thought that the Department of Financial Services in New York would.
Yeah, but I think that there are heavily regulated industries where the regulators have officially and semi-officially deputized either parts of firms or consulting firms or what have you, and they're their chosen fact gatherers. And they are as likely to tell you have to let them in to gather the facts as to allow you to. And that's a difficult discussion to have. So we'll move off of that paragraph and come to the one that begins separately. Now we're getting towards the end of the investigation. Separately, my drug's internal investigation, led by its general counsel, but employing outside counsel who, like Goldilocks's porridge, is neither too aggressive nor too passive, concludes its work. The internal review determines that the subsidiary's executives had inaccurately described the sales program to parents' management. Sales of two drugs had gone into markets for which the drugs were not then approved, but are now approved. And employees who questioned the sales plan were denied promotion or fired, but the review concludes that there were independent grounds sufficient to justify the termination or non-promotion decision for each of these employees. John, if I can start with you, there's probably a waterfall of legal consequences that follow from this. What are they, and what advice would you give my drugs in terms of how to respond?
Sure. So, as I said before, David has set up a really delicious hypothetical here that's got all sorts of problems baked into it. In terms of legal issues, the way I would approach this, I'd break it into the constituent pieces that we've got here. One, you've got a serious potential pharmaceutical regulation issue under the Food, Drug, and Cosmetics Act, as well as under the Pharmaceutical Drug Marketing Act. That is, it appears at least possible that we've been marketing and selling mislabeled or off-label drugs, marketing them for purposes for which they had not yet been approved by the FDA. Problem two is an issue under both the Anti-Kickback Statute and the False Claims Act. That is, we may have been marketing goods that were not lawfully subject to reimbursement under the Medicaid and Medicare program because they were not correctly labeled or not being used for the right purposes. And so we've got gifts going to doctors and other things going to doctors that arguably induced them to prescribe drugs unlawfully. And so you have a gigantic potential claim both under the False Claims Act and under the Anti-Kickback Statute. Third, you've got potential issues about unlawful retaliation against whistleblowers. You've got an allegation of that running through the hypothetical, which could cause problems for you under Dodd-Frank. Fourth, you have financial disclosure issues. I would be worried here that our CEO and CFO have been certifying under Sarbanes-Oxley, as they're required to do so, that we have an adequate and reasonable internal control environment. But if it turns out that we don't because we didn't adequately prepare for cyber risks, then you've got an issue there. And relatedly, you could potentially have financial disclosure issues because we might have made projections about the success of the drug marketing program that N drugs the subsidiary has been embarked upon that account for a substantial part of it. And then lastly, under Delaware law, I'd be worried, too, about the potential derivative liability of my board. Everyone knows, probably in this kind of a sophisticated audience, about the Caremark case dating back to 1996 and the subsequent cases in the Delaware Supreme Court, like Stone v. Ritter, that impose upon the board an obligation to have in place a minimum system of monitoring to ensure that issues get surfaced. And you'd also be wanting to worry that we look into and prepare for that possibility. So all of those trigger investigative chores. Each of them turn on different things. I'd want to put together a work plan quickly that will let me get at the potential liabilities arising in each of those different areas. I'd want to start looking at the email, or continuing to look at the email. I'd want to interview people, starting to understand, you know, what my potential liabilities are. And then, you know, moving from there, starting to work with regulators to try to start to, you know, explain to them what we've done, how we fixed the problem, or how we are planning to fix the problem, and trying to get, you know, my arms around the scale of it.
Mm-hmm. If you haven't yet spoken to the regulator, let's leave the FBI aside for a minute.
Right.
But if you haven't yet spoken to the regulator, particularly the SEC, let's say, because you or the FDA, at this point, would it be your strong advice that it's time to go in?
Yes, definitely. At this point, given, you know, where you've taken us in this miserable sequence, even slow-moving me would have figured out that it's time to go talk to the regulators.
Got it. So, Michele, up until now, we haven't spent a lot of time, although you did mention some of this in your first answer, but talking about what I'm going to loosely call the flank. We haven't talked about, you know, do I need to worry about insurance? Do I need, as a lawyer, to be thinking about whether reserves need to be taken here in the whole Section 5 analysis? And I was wondering at this stage, given what this investigation has determined so far, what steps you would be thinking about at this point as relates to some of those issues. Another one might be discipline and whether and how you create the mechanism for determining whether or not discipline needs to be imposed on any employee.
I think John's work plan, if you don't shoot yourself first, because there's so many things to do, but if you're truly focused, you're going to end up touching on all of that at the same time. They've got to be running parallel. Mm-hmm. There can't be a series of things that you do this, then you do that. No, you've got to have lots of people doing something all at the same time. And in regard to your insurance carrier, let's hope you have cyber insurance. Mm-hmm. I'm assuming most people do, although they probably don't have enough. So you would give notice to your carrier, absolutely. And how you do that's got to be in consultation with your lawyer so that you don't say something unwittingly when you file the claim.
Mm-hmm.
The other thing that's very obviously something you should have done at the beginning is to look at your prior disclosures in your public filings. Mm-hmm. Let's hope you've done a good job at that. Because if not, the question that could come up very early on is whether you have to do a special filing because something you've said earlier is now misleading. But that's all, again, at the beginning. If you're now trying to figure out, do you need to do a reserve, it goes without saying that the lawyers should have been in close contact with the controller and the CFO all along. And you should have brought in your outside auditor. And even though you can never tell them everything they want to know, and you have to explain to this every time, no, I'm not going to open up the gates and just sit you in the room with me, you've got to have enough trust between you. And again, this should have been developed over many years, mm-hmm. hopefully, that you're not talking to your outside auditor for the first time as general counsel, that you sit and explain orally what is transpiring, and then you need to make the discussion turn to ASC 450 and whether or not there is a probable loss or reasonably possible loss and all of the analysis that goes with that. If you decide there's a material loss is probable and you can estimate it, then you set up a reserve. I'm going to just take the argument that even though all of this litany of laws have been implicated, that it is reasonably possible that I'm going to have a loss, that I don't have to take an accrual, but I do have to do a disclosure. And the disclosure has to be descriptive enough without overstating so that the reasonable investor will understand what the company is up against. And that may mean you have to update it at some point in time.
Thank you.
You have to say, well, we've got a lot of exposures. Maybe that will be a material financial problem. And also, we've got a lot of risk of customer dissatisfaction, which may also have a materially negative impact.
And so what are you asking me?
I'm asking you, what do you have to disclose? And how do you make, and does it matter whether you say it's likely a material impact? And
yeah.
Who makes that judgment?
I think that's in consultation with the people that I've identified. That is with your financial people in the company, your outside counsel that works with you on disclosure. There's no company this size that wouldn't have outside counsel involved in disclosure issues. And there's a lot of judgment that goes into this. And you could end up being wrong, but you try to exercise the most reasonable judgment you can.
Yeah.
I don't think there's a crystal ball that says you're going to be right, but you want to be as close to right as you can be.
Yeah, I think, Bob, one of the things you'd have to take into account following on what Michele said is this involves a public company, but let's also assume you were working at a not-for-profit and you're pitching a big grant application, and people are relying on the financials that you're presenting about the health of your organization to get the grant. But if you're out there in the capital markets with documentation, you've got the obligation to make sure that it's presenting a fair picture of the organization, or you're going to have to update, or you're going to have to cease your activities in the capital markets, which I suspect is the least desirable option. So, you know, you're probably working on a fairly nuanced piece. If you can, you're probably trying to defer it till a regularly scheduled, K or Q or something like that, as opposed to having to do a special announcement. But
this is also where Michele's very good point from a little while ago comes into play. That is, you want to really closely study the existing financials. And it's also where another point that Michele made earlier is exactly right, that is be prepared.
Right.
So your financials, if you're a publicly traded company, ought to have robust risk factor discussion about cybersecurity, cyber risk, how we're going to prepare, how we're going to respond, how we're going to handle it. And it may well be that if you did it right, is robust enough and broad enough that it will carry you for a while until you have a deeper and better sense of what the facts really are in this specific
right.
instance.
And you would be consulting with your financial and legal experts to reach that determination.
Exactly.
So, Bob, I think the panel has set you up brilliantly for the next section, which is all about the board. And we heard about Caremark and some other cases. But in a telephonic board meeting that night, an independent director requests that the board retain independent counsel. But that request is rejected for cost reasons. She also learns that the general counsel and CEO have known of complaints about the subsidiary's sales incentive programs, but had not promptly informed the board. She's particularly concerned by two complaints. One is from another director's law firm that does work from time to time for MyDrugs. But the particular director is not involved in that work. The other complaint comes from a retired partner at MyDrugs accounting firm whose daughter uses one of their drugs. At the conclusion of the board meeting, the independent director announces that she is no longer comfortable with management's interactions with the board and with her potential liability as a director. She asks to resign effective immediately. Can she, and what risks does she accept if she decides to resign?
Well, if you'd asked me that question 5 years ago, I would have said, well, she's not imprisoned as a director and you can resign and not be liable for any future occurrences. But then in 2013, then Chancellor, now Chief Justice Strein, wrote an opinion in a case called Puta Cole, and said that, and in that case, all the directors but one resigned, and the then Chancellor said, well, they left the crook in place, and they couldn't do that, and therefore they would be liable for any harm that occurred from doing that. So here she's, you know, you've got to make a judgment as to whether or not, if she leaves the board, are the other directors able to monitor management, at least with respect to the future? And you'd have to ask, wouldn't she be better off staying, taking careful notes, reviewing the minutes carefully, doing what she can, and remembering she's just one of a number of people, of a number of board members. One other problem is, if she leaves, the company's going to have to promptly file an 8K that says that she's leaving and why she's leaving, and that may be pretty touchy.
Yeah,
one
Bob,
other question.
What would you say?
Hmm?
She wants to run out before the kitchen gets hotter? I mean, what are you going to put down?
Well, now let's.
Okay.
Because the next question she's going to ask is, can I have my own counsel to discuss this? And that actually ties in quite nicely with the 8K. Because if the general counsel of the company advises her, the outside counsel for the company advises her, then the company is going to learn information that it really wouldn't rather have. In other words, it'll learn what's going on in her mind. If she can have her own counsel, she can talk with her own counsel, talk through the reasons for why she would leave, and he can advise her and help her write the letter. And that's an expenditure that the company ought to be pleased to make.
Mm-hmm. Speaking of expenditures, in this paragraph, there's the observation that the GC and CEO had knowledge of at least some of the complaints, and at least one director was concerned that the board was not promptly notified. At this stage, should the board be considering hiring its own counsel to advise it with respect to the conduct of the CEO and GC?
I think they would certainly want to consider that very carefully. I don't think you can rely on the general counsel to supervise that, to make that investigation. Even the outside counsel who's been brought in by management, that'd be a little chancy. So I think the board, this is a situation where the board's got to do the investigation, got to satisfy itself, and it would be reasonable for the board to say, for that, we need to choose our own counsel.
But I would want to sound here, David, a note of caution, which mm-hmm. is, I think one way to make a bad problem worse is by having proliferating lawyers.
Mm-hmm.
As much as I dearly love our shared profession, you get 47 different sets of lawyers involved in the same problem. You get, 112 different answers. And so it can really become an unmanageable mess pretty fast. And I think you always have to be wary of bringing in law firms to represent, quote unquote, the board when you've already got, company counsel representing the company, which after all includes the board. Yes, there are circumstances where you need separate roles, where senior management has done something seriously wrong, and you just simply cannot trust management to supervise the matter. I don't know that we are in that situation here. There might be perfectly innocent reasons, or at a minimum, merely negligent reasons why the general counsel didn't bring this to the attention of the board earlier that may not be disqualifying once understood. So I think on this hypothetical, I'm not ready to say we need a whole other set of lawyers, with the expense, the time, the cumbersomeness, the potential for division that entails. There are obviously circumstances where that needs to happen. Wells Fargo is a good recent example. Shearman and Sterling was brought in by the board to do an inquiry because there were serious issues with management, and there you'd had literally, according to the report issued by the board, years and years and years of ignoring whistleblower report after whistleblower report after whistleblower report. We're not in that neighborhood yet here, and so I think you'd want to be cautious and careful. That's not advice you will necessarily get from every lawyer. I think, the entrepreneurship of lawyers is such that people will say, oh, you need 57 different law firms for everything.
But John, you're making, sure, 57 law firms you don't need. But if I'm a director and there is a serious question, and I took it from David's fact situation, that there is a serious question about the behavior of the CEO and the GC, I think, as a board member, I'd like my own counsel to look at it. Now, my own counsel may raise the questions you have and come back 3 days later and say, there's nothing here. Right. That depends on the firm you ask. Mm-hmm. And I don't think one ought to confuse it by saying it's Hines. 57 variety of lawyers.
But are we already assuming the CEO and company have asked for separate lawyers already based on these facts? Because it says that they knew about this and didn't disclose. So if they show up and say, look, we need our own counsel.
Yeah, I kept it ambiguous because...
You did.
Yeah. You don't know if what they know is that a few people have complained about the way the drugs are working, or whether somebody has complained that they didn't think the drug was for use with asthma, and they got it as an asthma patient. So there's some flexibility there, and I think it was designed, frankly, to evoke the conversation about what the board needs to do as it begins to get information that might suggest that it can't automatically accept everything from the GC.
But I think the point is that it's a factor to start to think about.
Exactly.
Right?
Exactly.
And consider.
Right.
Whether the GC should be running the investigation.
Right. And again, I would think to John's point, you would want a fair amount of evidence to suggest culpability of the GC before you would pull an investigation.
Other side of the... And I appreciate and actually agree with what John said, but the other regulatory side or enforcement side of that is imagine being the prosecutor who learns that there was some information available to the board in connection with undertaking this internal investigation that the general counsel had exposure, but allowed the general counsel to participate in the internal investigation. That is not a good...
That's exactly the issue. You've got to look at the potential credibility of the investigation results at the end of the day.
Then you're worried
that
about
is the coin of the realm.
You're worried about taint.
That's right.
As a prosecutor.
Right. Right.
And that's why, as a board member, I think I'd like to insist that the board have its own counsel.
I'm sensitive to the time. We had two other things we wanted to do. We had a brief final paragraph, and then we had a few summation points. I don't know if Beth or Stephanie are here. If people are willing to sit for, I promise, less than 5 minutes, we'll finish the hypo and the few summation points. And I'm taking from the nods of heads that we should do that. So
you're taking it from Stephanie saying thumbs up.
Yeah. Well, yep. So the last piece of the hypo.
You're much more patient than my law school class.
Yeah, Robert.
They start racing toward the door when the minute the clock strikes.
I don't even know where to go with that, John.
Go on to the
hypothetical.
Minutes,
okay. All right. Finally, the internal review determines that the end drugs management had funneled money through an intermediary to certain academic researchers at the Pristine Foundation, whose work supported the efficacy of two of N's drugs. The two drugs are meaningful. They represent 40% of my drug's projected revenue for the next 5 years. ENDS management caused the intermediary to represent incorrectly that the funds were not sourced from a pharmaceutical company. So since I was the one who put the double negative in the sentence, the point being that the researchers were unaware that they were receiving money from a drug company. As a result, there is no evidence that the Pristine Foundation's researchers were aware that ENDS drugs was a source of the funds. Judge, can we do no harm, no foul?
This is not an advisory opinion, but I don't see a legal duty here at all to tell the foundation. There's a separate issue that we were talking about before before the panel about whether, as a matter of just good judgment and your own reputation, you would want to tell the foundation. I thought, yes, some others were a little bit more dubious. I think here also that as a matter of the legal consequences for the foundation seems to, in this hypo, have had a good faith basis for not disclosing, I mean, not saying anything about the funds. They didn't know about it.
Yeah, I think that one of the points from this, as the judge said, is there are going to be many must questions that come up in the course of a crisis where legal considerations will drive what you do. You know, if there's an AML spin, you have to think about a SAR, for example. But crises often have should components to them, and the should components, allow the business people to start to make more of those judgments than those judgments in areas where they're being told what they must do relative to the requirements of the law. But secondarily, play into some of these other considerations like credibility that become so important, and who's controlling the messaging and when will the messaging come out. And I don't know if there's a right answer to this last piece of this hypothetical, but that's what it's designed to try to tease out. So with that, we put a few summary points together to try to distill down various things that at least we believe across the different disciplines in which we practice relate to the handling of crises. The first is that no two crises are the same, but you can find predictable patterns and typical issues. Second, that you must act, and it is far better to be proactive than reactive. Therefore, be nimble, move quickly, but don't lock yourself into positions unless you're confident of your facts and legal analysis. And I think you heard John in particular talking about not wanting to oversell and underdeliver to the regulators at the beginning. You must preserve credibility with all relevant constituencies, regulators, clients, law enforcement, employees, creditors, and potentially if you're in front of the judiciary. Don't let the corporate response itself create independent large problems for the organization. Bring in the expertise you need to handle the matter, except we now know the caveat that you can't have 57 lawyers. But bring in the expertise you need to handle the matter, but don't abdicate management of the crisis to others. So, for example, outside counsel may have strong relationships with regulators or law enforcement. You're hiring them for that. Use those relationships and heed their advice on how to present matters to those entities. By contrast, inside counsel and senior management is likely to have a far stronger feel for how the company's clients and employees will respond to developments and how competitors and creditors will react. Be hard on yourself. Others certainly will be. Know your weaknesses and plan for them. I think I can steal from John a little bit. We've seen some people go in front of Congress and perform magnificently when dealing with a corporate crisis. And we've seen a chairman who I won't name and CEO lose his job because of the way he performed in front of Congress. And I think you could see the difference in planning and preparation that went into the way different companies, whether it was GM or this other company, took the time to prepare to handle the hard questions. And then finally, protect your flank, have a media strategy, consider whether an insurance claim makes sense, whether employee discipline is required, and if so, make sure you follow the right protocols there, whether you have claims against third parties, and most importantly, take steps to prevent the underlying problem from occurring again. And with that, we thank you for your time and for the questions.